Good evening. My name is Vaughn Spencer, your newly re-elected city council president. And this evening, our program is entitled In Your City. And this evening with me, as I have former Councilman Mike Shorn with me to discuss a couple of topics that have been in the news and try to set the record straight on some things that have been mentioned in the news that aren't necessarily accurate, but you know, we will try to talk about all those different issues this evening. And we welcome home viewers to call in. The number is 610-378-0426. So Mike, how things been? And it's been a while since we've been on TV together, and
you were in a blackout because of
That's right.
All the political. And listen, congratulations to you.
Well, thank you. I appreciate it.
We did mention, obviously, the disappointing turnout
of
the city voters. And I don't know. I mean, obviously, you have to say that there's apathy, one. But it's a shame. I know how hard you worked, and I know how hard other people who wanted positions on council and the school board have worked. And to see that there's about a 12% turnout, or maybe even less in the city, is really disheartening. But it's the way it is today, you know. But congratulations to you, 64% plus. Thought that you were deserving, and I certainly echo their vote.
Well, it you know, you're always concerned for these particular primaries because traditionally they usually are low turnout primaries. However, I think the last time we may have had a little over 5,000 votes were cast in the council president race, and it was only a little over 3,000 votes. So when you put that in perspective as to the eligible voters here in the city of Reading, it was not good. And yeah, especially after a presidential election where we had such high numbers. And unfortunately, there were statewide judicial candidates who were selected to represent each party. And I know as far as the Democratic State Committee was concerned, I think only maybe two of their endorsed judges on that slate were actually elected through the primary process. So, you know, I'm sure that there's going to be a lot of rehashing and debate going on as to voter apathy, particularly in this election.
You know, I don't know what the answer is, but you know, I just think people are largely fed up with. I think they are. I think they're largely fed up with politics in general. You and I do know that while our hearts can be in it for the right reason, government and bureaucracy is very, very slow. It's a snail's pace to get things done, and you know, we have spoken about this often. And this is no offense to anyone who is there now, but I think that the form of government that we have, and certainly no offense to the charter board, but it's not the right form of government. It adds to the ineptness and the slowness of things, in my opinion.
Well, and you know, it's the unfortunate thing is that it's in these local elections where you try to elect people who you believe can make a difference. And to help make your quality of life better, but at the same time, with the low turnout, it is there are situations where maybe the best candidate sometimes doesn't get elected because the turnout was so poor. And you know, I think the big news was the major mayoral upset in Harrisburg, where you had a 7 time incumbent, everyone believed was a fantastic mayor, and because of low turnout, Mayor Reed lost.
That's
that
incredible.
Yeah.
You know, the other important thing is that, you know, locally, you know, I know that, you know, obviously you had a lot of sleepless nights. I'm sure that probably you got one decent one last night. But, you know, we have a school district here that runs or operates a $200 million budget.
Mm-hmm.
$200 million budget. And you had, you know, you had people running for school board, and with only 11.8%, if that's what it was, of registered voters in the city turning out, That doesn't say a lack of a lot either for the concern about, you know, who is really running the school district and for the right reasons. Yeah. You know what I mean? And both of us having spent the great majority of our lives in the classroom, there's nothing more important than trying to lead the urban youngster in the right direction and also providing them a safe haven on which to go to school. And, you know, I, very, very disappointing to me.
Well, I think the other issue is publicizing the primary election. I know I've run into people that ask me, well, when is the election? They asked me that today. And I have to remind them, well, the election was Tuesday. So, you know, do we do an adequate job? You know, during the presidential election, there was such a buildup and excitement going on that you know, you saw the turnout. For this primary election, you know, is it really the candidate's responsibility to energize the community? Or should there be other partners within the community building up the excitement for a primary race? I know on my campaign, I mean, we did radio ads. We were on Comcast. We were on Channel 69. We did newspaper ads. I was going door to door, handing out my door to door material, and also did a bulk mailing. And you know, you're doing that to, you know, let the people know that you're the candidate running, and then to find out that some people weren't even aware that the election was this past Tuesday. It's you know. It makes you stop and think what needs to be done. So, and then, of course, the other thing was, I believe there was the League of Women Voters debate, which was televised, mm-hmm. but there was only one other debate. And, you know, in a city this size, you would think that there would be more venues where you can get out in front of the people and be able to discuss the issues and your platform and what you would like to see done in a more meaningful way, because I think I've always been kind of critical of the candidate forums that we have, because a lot of times it's just a feel-good thing. You know, they ask you,
I agree.
Why are you running? They'll ask you one or two questions, and of course, in the case of second candidate's forum, it went from city council all the way down to school board all the way back. And so you never really got a chance to talk about the real issues of
right.
the city.
Right.
And so, you know.
You might have gotten 2 minutes.
Yeah. And I would strongly recommend that, you know, unless we make it more pertinent and unless we get around the city more so people can feel like they're a part of the process. Right. We might continue to get the same kind of turnouts that we've been getting.
I hope not. I hope not. I know that you are a consistent attendee at the College Heights Community Council meetings, which mm-hmm. Are usually the second Sunday of the month. Occasionally they change in the event that there's a holiday of some sort.
Sure.
But you have been, and that's a non-political neighborhood group. Generally,
right.
I mean, that's, you know, that. We don't go out of our way to do that anymore, and there's really a great turnout. You know, almost mm-hmm. monthly you have 60, 70, 80 people who are really interested in our city and in our community and our neighborhood. And I know there are, you know, a lot of neighborhood groups that I have heard that some of them, the attendance has, you know, has fallen off somewhat. But, you know, there was a point I wanted to make here, and that was I wanted to congratulate the Hillside Playground. You know, they always have their annual carnival, mm-hmm. You know, the beginning, second week in May. And, you know, starting in 2002, Vaughn, when you and I were together on council, there was we passed legislation that stated in 2002 that you may not use our poles, our wooden poles or our metallic poles for any type of advertisement, you know, because what it does is it really hurts the appearance, the aesthetics. I mean, it's degrading. Mm-hmm. And we passed that, And we were very passive about some of the things that, you know, we usually would contact someone if they were doing wrestling or boxing, or they were doing something at a particular club or something like that. We usually contact them and tell them if they didn't react, we would take down the posters. The Public Works Department would do that. And those people were sent a notice by our legal staff.
Yeah.
And there is an amount per poster that is a finable offense. I'll tell you what, this past weekend, I was appalled coming in 9th and 8th Street to see hundreds and hundreds of signs. Actually, it was in opposition to you, all over the place. And I certainly hope that those are down. And if the individual or the committee is listening right now, you know, we're going to commend all these organizations that try to raise funds for playgrounds and for community groups. And what they do is they go to the polls one, and they put their advertisement on a stake, and they put it in the ground right next to the pole rather than attaching it to the pole. You know what I mean? And mm-hmm. and these are for really solid reasons that they're being done, to advertise that they're having an amusement, a carnival, a parent organization or something like that. But you know, to just simply take advantage of things that are absolutely against the law, against our legislation. And it's up to us. It's just like one of many, Vaughn. It's a piece of legislation. It was put in place for a reason. It has to be enforced. Now, if people don't want to enforce it, then find someone who does. Okay? You and I have said that for a long time. It doesn't matter whether it's the city council, the city administration, the Reading School District, the police force. You don't want to work. You don't want to do what's supposed to be done, then go find another job. But those things better be done. I've offered to be deputized to go around and start collecting those things, because they deface the neighborhood.
Deputy Shoren, huh? Are they going to let you carry a gun or what?
No, I doubt it. No, I wouldn't do that anyway.
How about mace?
No, I'm not going to do that either.
Pepper spray, something like that. Well, you know, a lot of times during the program when I'm on, I would try to set the record straight on a couple of things. And I know that on Friday, May 8th, there was an article related to the cost fee studies that we were doing. And it's referred to as the Maximus study, because Maximus was a consultant that the city did an RFP for to help us figuring out our fees and fines and whether or not we're charging the appropriate amount. Council had asked for this study to be done because it was almost like 17 years since we really had anybody come in and look at our fees and fines. And of course, that information then was provided to the administration to make use of that and to come back to council with recommendation. I know that there was some collaborative efforts between the managing director's office and the city clerk and some of council staff, but obviously, you know, they'll come back with a recommendation for us to address. In the opinion page titled Cost Fee Study is Just the First Step for Reading Officials, they cited the issue that city council proposed increases in fees to close the gap between what it charges and the city's expense. They saw that as the issue. And in their opinion, that council missed a step. It should have examined why the costs are so high and then adjusted fees. So, again, I have to remind the editorial staff in the newspaper that council does not determine the amount the fees will be. That's not our job, that's administrative job. Ultimately, those ideas and recommendations come to us to say yay or nay, because that is our role as far as our fiduciary
right.
responsibilities. But as far as missing a step, we didn't miss a step at all. I would have to say that was the step maybe that the administration missed. Because I think the editorial writer is correct that you have to understand, you know, what precipitated these high costs, and why fees need to be adjusted, but that is not part of council's responsibility. So I had to inform the editorial staff of that, and every now and then, you know, that misinformation gets out there. And I think it's a blur of the form of government we're in. I think sometimes people still think we're under commission form of government, whereby council also ran departments, and one of the councilmen was designated as the mayor, and, you know, yeah, council had a lot of power under the commission form, as you well know. But under this home rule charter form of city government, where you have the bifurcation of the legislative and the administrative functions, council does not have the authority to direct and tell people what to do. However, we do represent the people's voice, and when proposals are brought to us that pertain to financial and fiduciary responsibilities, yes, this body will have to make the final vote. So if you saw that article, now you heard what the roles are. And of course, we will work collaboratively in addressing this issue of fines and fees. And hopefully we'll put something in place that makes sure that the city isn't necessarily losing money in its services that it provides, but yet at the same time to still make it affordable for the taxpayers and nonprofit organizations that might need to use city services.
I have to make a comment on that too. That was a great clarification on the part of, you know, the council's role there. But you know, there are two things that bother me about that. Number one, another study by someone outside coming in and telling us, you know, what we're doing right, wrong, or indifferent. And I included us as part because in 2000, 2001, there was a 10-year recreational plan done, mm-hmm. and it's sitting on the shelf. I mean, I have a copy of it at home. It's sitting on a shelf. If anybody would have maybe looked at that first before they did anything else, that may have been somewhat of an advantage. But the other thing that that bothers me is that these recommendations for giving out fields to youth groups and charging excessive amounts of money, you know, everyone misses the point here. You know, if you're giving out the field to an adult organization, the adults can come up with a buck or two each, you know, to help pay for that hour or 2 hours they have the field. But, you know, the kids, it's all youth related. I don't get it. I don't think anybody in this place gets it, because everybody is so worried about, you know, getting the dollars. What, I mean, some of the fields, because we don't even have enough people in maintenance to begin with right now, some of the fields are in not such hot shape, you know what
well,
I mean?
And I think you're being kind.
I am, you know, and you know, in fairness to Mike, you know, he does one, two, or three playgrounds a year, you know, refurbishes. The problem is that you should go back on a yearly basis, you know, and re-maintain. I mean, I have to look at the 11th and Pike Fieldhouse. I don't know if you've looked at that mm-hmm. at all lately, but that, you know, that used to be the mecca of recreation in the city.
That's right.
And it's an absolute disgrace right now. Yeah. The building was a disgrace from the time it was erected, although it didn't look that bad. But if you look closely at things, you know, it was shabbily done. But nothing has been done to it in 10 years. And if it wouldn't be for Rising Sun, nothing would be done to the field, because they take care of that. But I think raising fees for, you know, for things like benches and tables and things like, I think that they're missing the point totally. And you know, in this downturn economy, it's the worst time to do that. And didn't you say that the study had indicated that they wanted to maybe raise them as much as two and threefold?
Oh, yeah. I mean, well, see, and Mike, that's one of the reasons why maybe in this case it was good to have an organization come in. I agree with you with the RFPs and the consultants. I mean, at some point, your directors who you're paying a nice salary to should have some abilities to deal with some of the problems in their departments that they're running without always having to go to a consultant. But in this case, it proved to be very advantageous for the city, because if you remember, we were charging $50 for a housing permit. Now we're being told that really, as far as the cost of the city, we should have been charging anywhere from two, almost up to $400 in some instances.
Right.
Now, do you charge that amount? I mean, do you make that critical jump right away? I don't know. I think at some point that phase in, because in my mind, I'm trying to figure out how are you going from $50, you know, to $200. Who came up with the idea that $50 was enough?
Yeah,
and you know, and I think what was happening was that I don't know how that determination was being made, but obviously it wasn't being made based on factual evidence or true cost to the city. So this organization was pretty much able to do that. They came in and they really looked at who were all the people involved in the various steps of providing those services or the fees that you were looking for, and how was it impacting on their working hours and at what rate. In some of these things, you're absolutely right. I mean, should we be charging more? Yes. Should we be charging the total amount that was fully recommended? I think you have to have some discussion on that.
Absolutely.
And even the athletic fields. I know there one gentleman who had volunteered to go on to the Park and Recreation Boards, who was from out of state, and his whole thing was, yeah, we need to be doing more to help our recreation, park and recreations, and our fields, you know. And what are some of the ways in doing that? You know, is it possible to get some of the businesses to adopt the field, you know, to help the city maintain it? Because, as you know and I know, if you have the option of using a facility in the city or using a facility outside the facility, outside the city, mm-hmm. your main interest is which one is the nicer one to play on, or whether it be basketball court, or whether it be a baseball diamond.
Right.
You want a field that's nice. And you're absolutely right. Some of the fields that we have in the city of Reading are in such poor shape that you've seen that migration from leagues that used to be in the city. They've migrated out, you know, and you hardly have any of those acts because the facilities aren't the best, you know. And that's not the employees of the recreation department's fault.
No, they have no maintenance.
That's
staff.
Just the financial realities of what we're facing here.
Yeah.
I see we have a home viewer. Home viewer?
Hello.
Hello.
I'm enjoying this conversation very much, and especially about the facilities for kids for recreation. Questions in these studies, well, two questions. First mm-hmm. of all, in these studies that are being done, does anyone take into account what the costs are for delinquency of kids? And can you put a quantifiable number on that to make it understood that there's a tremendous value that goes with doing constructive things for children? That's number one.
That's a great point. That's a great point.
The second is the city is struggling for money to make all these good things happen. Before the city now is a proposal to give tax breaks for a hotel on Penn Street. My question would be, how would giving a tax break to a hotel on Penn Street help the 11th and Pike playgrounds, dilapidated field house? If there's not a way to draw that connection, I don't think that tax break should be given.
Well, to answer your first question, when Maximus did the fees and fines study, they were just looking at the cost of providing those services by the city departments. No, they did not look at what it costs for dealing with or adjudicating a delinquent minor and what the community is paying to have those costs taken care of. But you bring up a good point, because it's one of the many arguments that you have when you talk about do you want to spend money on a child, you know, in a more constructive manner through programs and helping this person become a part of the community, or do you want to pay for the incarceration of those people and what it costs? So No, we don't. We have not necessarily looked at that, but obviously, that plays in that whole concept of the importance of recreation, because it's either pay me now in a viable recreation program, or you're going to pay for it later on by incarcerating some of our youth in youth detention centers, or possibly in BCP or a state prison. You know.
Can I say something to that?
Yeah,
you want to get the two? He'll go to his second point.
Sure.
Here, right. But that's why when we talk about like organizations like Blacktop, you know, as affiliate, you're talking about 650 kids in the summertime, you know, or in an organized type of an environment, mm-hmm. where there is parental and grandparental, you know, involvement there, and. It seems to me that everybody who wants to talk about dumping recreation, including I see one of the former colleagues of ours who just was quoted in the paper yesterday as saying that we should outsource or look for alternative means of recreation for, you know, for our city kids, and you know, it hurts so bad when people who have really no idea about recreation and what it's really and truly all about, how to run it, what it involves, the time it's involved, make these kind of comments, you know, as if it's the same thing as outsourcing a paint job. You know, it's incredible to me. Recreation is on the bottom of the ladder on every city's economic platform, but it is probably the most important department that we have, especially in any urban situation or city, because of all of the kids we have almost 20,000 kids in the Reading School District. Mm-hmm. 20,000 kids in the Reading School District. Now, that doesn't take into account babies, and it doesn't take into account recent grads. And to think that, you know, you're not going to be trying to be out there up front with some kind of recreation or recreational opportunities is ludicrous. And every community, unless you have a real strong athletic interest, every community kind of feels like just throw it by the wayside. Somebody else will take care of it.
Yeah.
It's just mind-boggling to me. Thank God we have Blacktop, 18 years of what they do up there for a good 2 months to keep people actively involved, and for the most part, it's wholesome, organized, and informative.
Yeah. Well, and the second part of that question, the tax break issue, that's a delicate situation from the standpoint that many times to get development to come into the city of Reading, you're competing. You know, well, whether it's Reading or any other city in Pennsylvania, you're competing for that business. And of course, you've got to be prepared to offer something. You've got to be prepared to either offer a site that has been cleared, or some source of revenue streams, what have you, or in this case, KOZ status, which means that you don't pay any taxes for X number of years. So I think you have to handle that very judiciously, and I think you have to ask the question, will this development help to revitalize the city in the way in which you want? And that centers around this whole topic of the hotel. You know, for years, the people at the Sovereign Center, SMG, have been saying if Reading had a hotel conference facilities, that they would be able to probably bring conferences in and also be able to maximize the Sovereign Center itself. The Abe Lincoln, although it's a historic hotel, just did not have the amenities that people want when they go to stay in a hotel. So that's why we were having a lot of people going to the Sheraton. But that was not helping the city, bringing people in town and possibly spending money in the city. So the whole idea behind the hotel and the raising of the monies that needed to be, which quite frankly, we got a lot of money from the state on that, and also there's been individual contributors to that. The whole idea there was to be able to give the Sovereign Center and Reading the ability to maximize some of our revitalization issues here in the city. I don't endorse doing KOZ and tax break projects willy-nilly throughout the city. I think that, first of all, it's got to benefit the city, and second of all, it's got to be in a situation where the city basically is going to have some kind of control in those processes. To give a tax break or a KOZ land to a private developer, let's say whatever might happen at the outlets at 9th and Douglas or at 8th and Ole or some of those other places, you have people that own those buildings. Now, if they are not in a position to develop those buildings, then maybe they ought to consider turning those buildings over to the redevelopment authority of the city, mm-hmm. which has then the ability to clear the land and possibly go seek developers that are going to be able to be more responsible to the city itself. But so to answer your question, yes, we have to do those things, but I think you have to really think it through, and you don't want to just give tax break situations out if it doesn't make sense. The unfortunate thing is that you're constantly competing for economic development in your areas. Remember the KVP Falcon?
I remember all of it.
We were in competition with Danville, Virginia. Who wanted that same company, remember, to relocate there, and they were prepared to offer land and a lot of other things. We were able to get them to relocate here. Yes, they did get tax breaks. Yes, there were a lot of people in the community that kind of tried to smooth the company to come here, mm-hmm. and Redding benefited from that. And just like with Sunridge Fresh Fruits and Hydrojet relocating in the Buttonwood Gateway area. So, you know, we're trying to keep as viable as possible. We're hoping that after the tax break status eclipse, that these companies will stay, because that's the other issue you have. Right. Some of these companies are so flexible, and there's such a demand in this global market that sometimes they'll stay long enough until their tax break status ends, and then they move. They'll leave the area. So when we do that with businesses, it's with the understanding that this business is making a long-time commitment to the city. But we have another home viewer. Home viewer? Home viewer? Did we lose?
Yes. Good evening, Vaughn. Congratulations on your win this week.
Thank you. I recognize the voice.
Yes. Who do we have in city government that could be an emissary that we could send around the country to bring business in here? Anybody that has contacts and that type of business to bring business in here.
That's a good point. That BEP, Berks Economic Partnership, is acting as an umbrella for economic development concerns for Greater Reading. And of course, they advertise, and they also have contracts with various federal lobbying groups, and they also advertise the community along with the Greater Berks Visitor Center. But as far as someone for the city of Reading actually going out and advocating just for Reading, we don't really have anything like that in place. And I've always maintained that I don't believe we do a good enough job of advertising or publicizing our city ourselves. And even to talk about all the positive things that go on. Every now and then, I think the mayor has been involved with some ads highlighting the city of Reading, but I don't know how far of an outreach nationwide that's happening there. But yes, there are some organizations that are working to highlight Greater Reading, not necessarily particularly the city of Reading, but Greater Reading.
Yeah, I think that would be an avenue that you guys may want to look at, creating that for the city to start bringing business in. On another note, we talk about all the bad stuff in Reading.
happened to meet a couple. They were from Denmark yesterday. They were driving around the mountain, and they stopped and they asked me directions, and they were talking about the town and how good it looked, you know, all the architecture and so on. But it was refreshing to get a positive comment from somebody that doesn't live here, of course, but
sure.
That was really an interesting comment that they made.
Well, there's a lot of positives here in the city of Reading.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, I know former Councilman Shorn always used to say, and I'm included, that there's a lot of attributes here. There's still a lot of hope for this city. But at the same time, we cannot continue to allow properties and neighborhoods in this city to deteriorate in the fashion that we see. So it's a matter of maintaining those strong neighborhoods, which we have some wonderfully strong neighborhoods in the city, but yet at the same time, constantly working to rehab and to revitalize some of the other neighborhoods. And a lot of that has to do with the whole housing and permitting and the zoning and the illegal conversions of things that are going on. And that's why it's so important that we enforce the ordinances that we have in place, and that we go after disruptive tenants and what have you, because ultimately it's those quality of life issues that people are making a determination as to, do they want to stay in the city or do they want to leave? And we need to continue to put that positive face on there and continue to positively advertise our city, because yes, it is a great place to live in.
Yeah, I'm glad to see that. I am glad to see that there is movement on the permitting process. I did watch your with Marty Mays on the other night at your work session, and his comments were quite interesting. And it seems like something is being done now, and we are moving forward. So that is a positive.
It's a little slow, but there is positive movement, and we need to continue to move in that direction. And yet at the same time, you know, I just received a letter from someone living in the Madison Avenue area that, you know, they came here, bought a property, raising their family, and are dealing with some of the problems that many of us are dealing with in neighborhoods, and is getting frustrated because they feel that they're not getting the support by the city in dealing with some of these disruptive properties.
I think that communication is an issue down at City Hall overall.
Yes.
And it's very confusing to people. They feel like they're not being addressed, especially when you have something not getting addressed for 4 or 5 months at a time.
Yes.
And then when it is addressed, you know, you still get a confusing answer, or, you know, we don't know what's happening. So
right.
That needs to stop in order for this to, you know, be progress further, I should say.
Absolutely correct. Mike, I didn't know if you had any comments.
Yeah, I did. I wanted to just say one thing to the gentleman, and that is that when you had talked about someone going out and trying to bring some people into our city, I have to do a shout out here for Albert Boscov. I know that Albert Boscov is not employed by the city of Reading, but Albert Boscov is on all of those foundations, and he chose to put his energy and his efforts into trying to bring people into the city, not just greater Reading area, but into the city of Reading. Mm-hmm. So for 10 years he has actively worked. I mean, he has had numerous meetings with the governor. He has done so much to bring positiveness in here. Now, I know that the hotel thing has been going on for 4 years, and I know he's not happy about it, but he wants to bring a quality hotel in here. And as Vaughn said, every time you think you're so darn close, then we have the economic downturn, then we have a big rise in copper, or we have a big rise in certain energy. I mean, it has been one thing after another. And it's also been a 9 to 12 month ordeal with planning and zoning here in the city. going through every hoop in the world to get something done, and that happens to everybody. And that's why what you just said, about 5 months, you don't get the right answer, or you get an answer that's vague, or no one knows what they're doing or what they're talking about. That's why this form of government is wrong. Under the old form of government, if you had a particular problem, someone would be able to act on that and react on that. And in 72 hours, if you didn't have an answer, then that person would be accountable for it. And that's what's wrong with this form of government. It is too spread out, and it's just not efficient.
They've taken the check out of balance, basically. There is no checks and balances there, as I see it. You know, I hate to be so harsh and critical of the administration from time to time, but it's an easy pick. You know, and what else can I say? On Mr. Boskov, you know, the guy, you know, he's one of the entrepreneurs, one of the oldest entrepreneurs we've had here in the area, and my hat's off to him. I'm so glad that he's gotten involved in, you know, moving things forward here. We do need other entrepreneurs to get involved also and, you know, become public and be more of an impact also.
Good point.
That's all I have to say for this.
Thank you.
And I will talk to you guys later.
Thanks. Thank you. But it brings up an interesting topic. I mean, you know, we talk about Greater Reading, but then a lot of times comments are made that we don't want to be seen subsidizing the city of Reading. It's not the city of Reading. It's the county seat. Berks County, and it's the location of your county government, it's the location of your largest municipality in the county, and for all of those reasons, when you have people who come into the area from outside the area, first thing they want to know is, well, where are your governmental services, where's your main center point, where's your largest concentration of people? It's in the county seat of Berks County, Reading, the city of Reading. And, you know, there was a time when the city was the main financial generator for the entire county.
Right.
You know, we're providing a lot of the recreation for everybody in the county. This is where you came, you know, if you wanted to purchase things, to buy and sell goods and stuff. This was the place. Now things have changed, and we've lost our industry. A lot of people worked in the city, even though they didn't live in the city. Mm-hmm. But because of the changes that have gone on through this global economy and throughout Pennsylvania, all the third-class county mm-hmm. seats of various counties are experiencing the same thing Reading's experienced. But that's all the more reason why, you know, we need to be able to help now the county seat, the city of Reading. Who is not in a position where it was before, but yet at the same time needs the help of shared revenue. And I often get a little frustrated when I hear that argument that it's not our job to subsidize the city of Reading. This is where your county government is. This is where a lot of your major business headquarters are. It's in this city. Mm-hmm. And you need to make sure that this city still looks like a prime spot to attract tourists, to also be the kind of highlight of your county. Mm-hmm. And some counties understand that. I mean, Lancaster County understands that the city of Lancaster is the county seat. Mm-hmm. Lehigh County understands that the city of Allentown is the county seat. Mm-hmm. And Easton with Northampton, and you can go on down the line. Mm-hmm. I don't know if all of the decision makers in Berks County, whether or not you're a township official or a borough or a supervisor, understand that significance and the importance of making sure that your county seat still becomes a viable spot. And a true picture of your county.
I agree.
And we'll continue to have that discussion, but
just since you and I were together on council, and I'm off now over 3 years. Just think, we've lost Dana, we've lost what was used to be called Western Electric. Mm-hmm. Have you been out past Liddens lately?
Oh,
I mean, there isn't even a facility
gone.
There. I mean, it's gone. And now out in my area, the Northeast area, we've lost Dimensions.
That's right.
Which, you know, was a great employer. And
lost Ludens.
And I'm sorry, and we've lost Ludens. You know, I mean, those are all within the last 2 years.
That's right.
On a positive note, I would like to tell you that the state has mandated recycling, as you know. And for 2 years, I know the Reading School District, and that whole mandate is coming closely to an end. And I would like to give a shout out to Mr. Knowles from the Reading School District and his immediate staff. They're working very, very well with Frank and with Larry Murin. I'm sure you remember Larry. Mm-hmm. I know Larry very well, in trying to bring together a partnership between the city and the school district with regards to recycling. Frank has done a great job in acquiring over $200,000 for a new recycling truck. He has gotten over 1,000 containers that are going to be placed in the schools. We're just hoping that everyone on the school district appreciates, you know, what Frank has done and what he's been able to acquire, because quite honestly, the school district could be sitting there being fined monthly, mm-hmm. you know, for not following mandates. And, you know, hopefully by September, everything will be in place. And there are so many schools, your school at Southern, mm-hmm. At Northeast, and at Northwest with Denny Campbell, although Denny will be leaving shortly to go to the Citadel. But those three schools, and I'm sure there are plenty of others. I know 12th and Marion's doing it. I know Amanda Stout is doing it. There's so many of the kids there are so actively involved in the recycling efforts, you know. So they're doing a great job with regard to that. And my hat's off, because that's all a volunteer effort on the part of kids and on the part of a few teachers who really care. Those who are involved with environmental sciences, and those who are at your school, it's an altruistic club that is being run down there, but they also talk about quality of life in neighborhood, and they do a lot of anti-litter types of things. So a lot of really good things going on in the Reading School District. You know what these are, certainly. But
yeah,
just wanted to show you. Got these the other day, folks, in case you're ever thinking about just trying to do it to help out a little bit. This was a donation from one of the elementary schools, 12th and Marion. Teachers had started a classroom project one, and the kids would put in those metal tabs from the Coke cans or soda cans. And they brought them in. These go to a teacher at Northeast who collects them. Northeast has been doing it for about 7 years. And they send them to the Ronald McDonald House, you know, where it goes to a foundation. Mm-hmm. And in turn, they get money to help treat young kids who are in need of some serious medical assistance and medical help. But just something small like that, I just thought it would be great to let people know. And the city also does this. If you have any disposable batteries, rather than throwing them in your trash can, you can send them, or you can drop them off at City Hall. They will take care of that for you. Or if anyone is watching and you know me or you know where I live, drop them off at my house. I'll make sure that they get properly recycled rather than throwing them in a landfill.
Well, I don't know if that was a lead in to what I was going to mention next, but Bernhard's Dam has been in the news again. And of course, this I was quoting in another opinion page, me and some of the other members of council, but, you know, we've been going round and round on this thing with Exide, and, you know, Exide basically was responsible for some of the contamination in Muhlenberg Township, some of the residential neighborhoods over
sure.
by Bernhard's. And, of course, Bernhard's dam itself, there's areas that now we're being told that, you know, you can be there, but if you're bringing a dog there, you need to wash the dog off when he gets home and wash off shoes, and you can't play in the dirt, and can't, if you catch any fish in the water, you shouldn't try to eat it. Or, I mean, it's just ridiculous.
It is ridiculous.
And of course, we've been going round and round on this issue. And all the city is saying is, give us our park in the same condition it was before you contaminated it. And of course, now we're getting down to the nitty-gritty, and it looks like there's not going to be much more movement as far as cleanup efforts. So All I can say to the listening audience is stay tuned, because this is going to continue, and it could possibly end up with us possibly having to do some litigation. And then we had the issue of graffiti, Mr. Shorn. Have you noticed all the graffiti around here?
Don't upset me. Terrible.
I know that there's efforts being made to clean up this graffiti, but it's getting worse. I mean, it is absolutely getting worse. And we're being told that they are catching some of the, I'm not even going to call them artists, I'm going to call them felons.
They are felons.
Yeah, they're destroying
they
people's
felons.
Property.
No respect
and,
at all.
You know, what's taking place now is just totally ridiculous. And I know we need to find an avenue for some of these so-called street artists to be able to do it in a way that's not going to destroy property. But at the same time, I think we need to be more aggressive
Much
with
more aggressive.
The punishment at the end of the aspect. But, so again, if you have graffiti occurring, contact the service center with the city or council offices, report that property so we can get it on the list. I know that there's an effort by way of the county. The city is cooperating with those efforts to address trying to clean this up. And again, the damage it's doing to the appearance of our city. Also, we had the canine issue. And of course, we dealt with that issue previously, if you remember.
Yeah, but this time it's really ludicrous.
Yeah,
really.
Well, and I think it'll get resolved. I think community pressure from one end, and also could be pressure from rank and file, because police officers understand the importance of having the ability to have a canine dog in certain situations.
Sure.
So I think pressure might come from the community and come up through the ranks that, you know, the FOP and the chief need to resolve this so that all the groups that contributed money, we had drug forfeiture money that went towards these efforts and all the other things that need to take place to make sure that we have a canine force in position. I'm hoping that gets resolved. But on another note, and I'll finish this up, and then if you have some last comments, I think we're getting down to the wire. But quality of life issues, particularly this time of the year, I mention it time and time, but because we live in a row home situation, we've got to be sympathetic to our actions and our actions impact on our neighbors. Loud music, particularly late at night, you know, the issues of cutting your grass, you know, and the condition of your yard, because a lot of people want to be in their backyards and want to do things. And if you have a pet, particularly, you need to make sure you clean up behind that pet, because there's nothing worse than you wanting to sit out in your backyard and you got to smell the aroma that's taking place from the yard next to you. So I'm asking that everybody be considerate of the people living around you. And I think if we can do that, we should have a nice summer. And of course, if you are experiencing problems related to quality of life issues, don't hesitate to report them. And hopefully, action will be taken on those situations that are causing a hardship for the neighborhood. Mike?
I just wanted to, first of all, I want to shout out to my grandchildren who I'm supposed to be babysitting tonight, and my wife's doing that till I get home. So to Julie and Joseph, hello and probably good night.
So you put it on Kathy.
I did, but
wow.
She's such a great person. Anyone who knows her would certainly understand I'm telling the truth.
To put but, how long have you been married, Mike?
Long time. 40 years.
Oh, wow.
40 years coming up.
Yeah.
Yeah. And happily married.
Well, I'm sure. I'm sure.
I benefited there, didn't I?
Great wife.
Great wife.
You have a great wife.
Wanted to tell you that, have you seen the Woods Are Wonderful litter cans have been all over. And it's not just, I don't want to just say what's a wonderful, but that organization, and anyone who has ever listened to me, I talk about them all the time.
The Browns.
They work, Louise and Doug Brown. Yeah. But they work with the kids, they have worked with like 7 or 8 elementary schools and 2 middle schools, Northeast and Northwest, and every time they come back, they are with the greatest bunch of kids. Yeah. The kids help to do the stenciling, and when they're finished, I mean, they are just so so ecstatic as to the appearance of the cans, and they've been going, you know, all over the place, and that is a joint effort with the city of Reading.
I know.
You know, so it's, you know, public-private partnerships can work, you know, if people are willing to do that. You know, they don't get any public dollars. They don't benefit from the United Way or anything like that. As a matter of fact, haven't even been given an opportunity to apply for United Way funding. They do that because they're really very caring individuals. And I'm so very, very proud of them and the product that is going around all of the schools, and they're really being utilized very, very much. Mm-hmm. I don't know how much time you have left, but...
Well, I think we're getting ready to get that message.
Are you?
Yeah,
but Blacktop basketball starts June 17th. And I know the guys like to see you come up there. June the 17th is the opening night. They're expecting a little over 650 kids.
Yeah,
they like seeing you up there. So I think next month, if at all possible, we're going to have some people on from Blacktop.
And anyone in the listening audience, if you haven't ever had the opportunity to get up to City Park during the Blacktop games, it's really an experience, first of all, to see all those kids involved in something positive. And not just kids from the city. You have kids from teams from outside the city and various areas of the county. So, you know, it reinforces that whole thing that there's a stigma of some people are afraid to come in the city. That's a bunch of crap. I think what really goes on is that the more we get a chance to interact and for people to come into the city, the more they find it a place that they want to come back, whether it's to the IMAX Theater, whether it's to the Goggle Works, whether it's to see an activity at Reading High, at the Sovereign Center. And to eat at some of our eating establishments. You can have a great time here in the city of Reading. I would just like to say in closing, did you have something
just
else?
I just want to tell you, now Memorial Day is coming up, and there is a proper way to dispose of old flags in the event that you do not know that. Then the city of Reading, up in the recycling office, will take care of that rather than just simply throwing them away and discarding them willy-nilly. Have a little respect for the flag, and if they are worn or tattered, I'll take them into City Hall, and we will properly dispose of them.
That definitely looks like it's worn.
It is.
It's tattered. Yeah. Okay, we're out of time. Again, thank you for listening. Thank you, home viewers, for calling in. And until we see you again, on behalf of former Councilman Shorn and myself, have a great summer.